boutique and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot.
Ooh, bah, 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 bah. Ooh, bah, 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 bah.
They took all the trees, put them in a tree museum. And they charge the people a dollar and a half just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paid paradise, put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, farmer, put away the DDT now. Give me spots on my apples, or leave me the birds and the bees. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. Late last night, I heard the screen door slam, and a big yellow taxi took away my old man. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot.
Ooh,
I said, don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They pay paradise, put up a parking lot. They pay paradise, put up a parking lot.
Up a parking lot.
On the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. Our things ain't what they used to be. Radiation underground and in the sky, animals and birds who live nearby are dying. Mercy, mercy, me. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more be used from man? Can't you stand?
Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started in about 1 minute. Please continue to introduce yourselves in the chat. Tell us where you're from. We'll get started in about 60 seconds. Thanks. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm thrilled to see so many folks joining us from all across the state of Washington today. My name is Ken Letterman, and I'm very proud to serve as the board chair of Washington Conservation Voters. And I want to welcome you all to the 2021 Virtual Gathering of Champions. Thank you so much for taking time during your lunch hour today. I'm going to start off by letting you know that we're offering this program in Spanish. So if you would like to listen in Spanish, please see the instructions on how to access this in the chat. And our deep thanks to our Spanish interpreters, we're working hard to make sure today's event is accessible for everyone. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, Washington Conservation Voters works to ensure that everyone in Washington State has a healthy and just environment, community, and economy. We do this by mobilizing the public, electing and supporting public officials, and holding them accountable. We're fortunate in Washington State to have so many people doing great things, and many of them are here with us virtually today. We literally have dozens of elected officials and tribal leaders joining us today. Thank you for being with us. We are truly grateful for your hard work and your commitment to Washington's people and the environment. We also want to give a big shout out to our sponsors. We deeply appreciate all of you for your financial support of our work. And finally, a big thank you to all of our team captains today who helped rally all of you to attend our virtual event today. We have an interesting and inspiring program for you. Over the next hour, you'll hear from WCV's Legislator of the Year, Representative Joe Fitzgibbon from the 34th District. Then our CEO, Alyssa Macy, will be hosting a very special roundtable discussion on how removing the lower Snake River dams will impact the health of our communities, our environment, our salmon, and our southern resident orca population. We're deeply honored that Shannon Wheeler, Vice Chairperson of the Nez Perce Tribe, and Governor Jay Inslee, of Washington State, are both here to share their perspectives with us during this discussion. Now, we're also here today to celebrate our shared successes, talk about what's ahead for all of us, and to raise funds to support WCV's work. Thanks to your generosity at this event every year, we raise unrestricted funds to support WCV. Our goal today is to raise $150,000, and we're coming into that with half of it already raised. Over the next hour, we're looking to you to help us raise another $75,000. We hope that everyone attending today's event will make a donation that is personally meaningful to you. It could be $5, it could be $50, $500, or maybe even $5,000. But our ask of you today is not just to give what you can, but to stretch yourself and give generously so we can continue our efforts to make sure that the environment remains a top priority for public officials at all levels of government across Washington. And as an incentive, you have a rare opportunity to double your investment today. We have a matching challenge for some generous donors that will be matching all $1,000 donations dollar for dollar, as well as matching all first-time donations dollar for dollar. So please be bold and help double our impact. There are instructions on how to donate that have been posted in the chat. Please feel free to give at any point during the program. Now, we really look forward to the day when we can all be together again in person. But in our virtual space, the next best thing is a lively chat. So we encourage you to participate. Send out those hellos, high fives, emojis, and share your love for these amazing salmon tea towels that many of you received as ticket purchasers. Tell us how you're using them, how you've changed your kitchen decor around them, any great spills that you've cleaned up. They all go into my special online tea towel diary. Wow, I really need a life. Anyway, We'll be kicking off today's program with a poem. Jen Preston Shishkoff created a poetry walk celebrating the Donkey Creek Salmon Run in Gig Harbor. She's really passionate about protecting our environment, and it's her life's work to do it through her art form. We're very grateful for her contributions today.
The rivers are still, thick with silence in their drowsy, patient wait before the fall. Even now, 100 years have passed and fish return to toss themselves up, up, up the concrete bier, but never over, never breachable, with abdomens full of living pearls, soft spheres pulsing. Home, home, home is all they hear. Every muscle twitches, contracts this truth. Native stories live like mists, like shy ghosts on lonely shores. This place, once so full of fish, we crossed the river on their backs. A sound came to me at night, like hundreds of oars slapping the water. The salmon had returned. My heart is with the man that guards a quiet pool full of quick silver flashes. It's too far to travel, he says, up the river, past the dam's fish ladders and death-defying leaps, to come to this fern-lined pond of fanning gills and be sacrificed. Something buried deep also calls us home, 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 and we are never closer than at the water's edge.
My name is Alyssa Macy, and I'm a citizen of the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs, Oregon. I'm also the CEO of Washington Conservation Voters. Thank you, Jen, for sharing such a beautiful, inspiring poem, and thank you to all of you for being here with us today. I often talk about what pulls my heart, my North Star in the world, and that is protecting a relative who is in grave danger of extinction. Waikanish or salmon. In my culture and many cultures throughout our region, salmon are a part of our origin stories and culture and spiritual lifeways. They also teach us about cycles replenished by prayers of gratitude. The salmon knew our highest regard for them, and we knew them as our relatives. This past weekend, I spent some time in the South Fork of the Nooksack River and witnessed firsthand the return of coho salmon, both to the Wild River and to the Lummi Nation Skookum Creek Fish Hatchery. They showed me their incredible strength, born in the waters of the South Fork, traveling to the Salish Sea, to the Pacific Ocean, some traveling as far as the Gulf of Alaska, and returning home to the place where they started. Our relatives' life journey teaches us the importance of place and cycle. I am so privileged to know so many Lummi Nation tribal members who continue to fish as their ancestors have since time immemorial. When I have joined them on their vessels, I see them at their best. Their spirit knows that this is their place and they are connected to their ancestors. They know the water, the currents, the weather patterns, and the stories that connect them to their ancestral waters. And they understand the cycles that bring them out on the Salish Sea throughout the year. We too are in a cycle right now. Human and corporate actions are having a negative impact on our environment, and we are witnessing the consequences of those decisions. Record droughts, warming waters, catastrophic climate fires, poor air quality, and devastating oil spills in our waters. And we are also witnessing how this is impacting our relations. All living things on the planet, you and me, and we future ancestors, all of us, are also writing history in this moment. Our actions today to address the climate crisis will be what our grandchildren will read about and hopefully celebrate in the future. So much has happened since I joined WCV in January of 2020, witnessing the great pause, a global pandemic, being in Minneapolis when George Floyd lost his life at the hands of police officers, and perhaps now my hope entering into the great healing. Organizations like WCV must focus on environmental justice, centering the voices of those most impacted by climate change. This includes working closely with tribal nations by honoring and upholding tribal sovereignty through our actions. WCV is committed to ensuring that everyone in Washington can live in a healthy and just environment, community, and economy. This means ensuring structures and systems are equitable at every level across our state. We contribute to this work by mobilizing the public to take action, electing champions for the environment, and holding our leaders accountable. Through multiple election cycles, we've shifted the state legislature to environmental majorities and elected new inspiring leaders like Senator Tawana Nobles, and our state has adopted some of the most progressive and equitable climate policies in the nation, like the Climate Commitment Act and the Low Carbon Fuel Standard. We also celebrate the passage of the HEAL Act, led by Front and Center and champion Senator Rebecca Saldana, which embeds environmental justice into state law. These policies are made possible by the steadfast work of coalition efforts and people-powered movements to drive them forward. WCEB's efforts have reshaped the leadership in city and county councils and port commissions. We've helped elect some incredible leaders on the front lines of fighting fossil fuel interests. Port Commissioners Don Orange and Eric LeBrant in Vancouver, City Council Member Christina Walker and Port Commissioner Christine Ng in Tacoma, County Executive Satal Sidhu and Council Member Carol Frazee in Whatcom County, just to name a few. This electoral work, coupled with really smart and strategic coalition work, has a remarkable track record in stopping fossil fuel corporations from extending their footprint in our state. And we know there is no climate policy without a healthy democracy, and we are proud to support the work of the Washington Voting Justice Coalition and leaders like Representative Tara Simmons to expand voting justice in our state. Through their leadership, we celebrate the restoration of voting rights to almost 20,000 voters this past legislative session. But honestly, the most valuable work we've taken on has been our internal work, our journey to become a more anti-racist organization. We acknowledge that the position and power we've held over 40 years of advocacy left many people and communities behind, and we are committed to doing better. This year, we approved a new strategic framework, a guiding document embedding our values and principles into the vision of who we need to be for people and Mother Earth for now and for the future of our organization. Fundamental to our work will be supporting the voices of communities, especially Indigenous and Black and African American voices, and ensuring that they are represented in decision-making and political processes. We know that with the pro-environment state government, strong local leaders, and your help, we can continue to pursue innovative solutions to the environmental challenges we face. Last year, WCV launched Evergreen Future, a four-year campaign to push elected officials to support bold environmental action. Evergreen Future provides a roadmap to show us how leaders can tackle our biggest health and environmental challenges. Washington conservation voters ask candidates and elected officials to support and commit to a policy platform that creates a better future for all Washingtonians. We are now taking that platform to the local level and are working with candidates, over 120 of them, who have also endorsed the vision. Here is a short video about the Evergreen Future campaign.
We launched Evergreen Future in 2020, and legislative candidates endorsed the platform and won. In the 2021 legislative session, leaders made significant progress in issues across the platform.
The Evergreen Future platform enables us to put an intersectional lens on our policy and campaigns, and to really make the connection between our electoral progress and policy wins at the local and state legislative level. There's a direct connection between the record number of people of color running on environmental justice platforms in 2020 and the major policy wins of the 2021 legislative session.
Now local elected officials embracing the platform can collaborate with state officials to focus in on community-based intersectional solutions such as local climate action planning that impacts racial and economic justice close to home. For example, I'm excited to work with housing justice activists and youth climate justice activists to update the Growth Management Act.
These pillars represent a roadmap of what we need to secure for a more sustainable and equitable future for our state. We need to make investments now in clean water, community forests, and environmental justice solutions for Black and Indigenous people most directly impacted by the climate crisis.
Mona Das from the 47th District, proud to serve members in the Auburn, Kent, Covington communities, and a little bit of Renton and a small bit of Black Diamond. I'm also very honored and proud to support the Evergreen Future.
Hi, my name is Kim Kanvan, and I'm running for King County Council District 9. I'm super excited. I've signed on to support Evergreen Future platform, and I hope that we can all work together to support our environment and our communities.
I think for me, the Evergreen Future platform really encompasses a holistic perspective on not only environmental justice, but holding corporate polluters accountable, as well as taking care of our environment, our air, our water.
The Evergreen Future platform really supports our community work. The asphalt plant that was sited on the Cedar River on SR 169 Renton Maple Valley Highway has been very much an issue in our district. And with the support and education that's coming out with Evergreen Future Platform, it really ties into how our community here can be supported. So at the state level, while legislators are making policies, city council members and county council members are able to implement it and making sure that we are supporting our communities.
So when we did the plastics legislation, we heard from so many kids. They drew pictures, which were, you know, absolutely heartbreaking. They are envisioning a bleak future for themselves, and they are asking us as legislators to act now so their future is bright for them as they grow older.
An evergreen future is only possible by having elected officials in office who are willing to take bold, decisive action for our environment and communities. Each year, WCV honors a legislator who demonstrates this kind of action. And today we are honoring Representative Fitzgibbon for his persistence and hard work to bring folks together for environmental progress. His recent accomplishments are so meaningful for our futures that we wanted to recognize him as the first ever two-time winner. Please welcome WCV's 2021 Legislator of the Year, Representative Joe Fitzgibbon. Hi, Joe.
Hi, Alyssa. Thank you so much for this award. It really does not belong to me alone. This recognition deserves to be shared among all the House and Senate Democrats who have worked hard this year and over the past 3 years to achieve a landmark series of climate protection and environmental justice laws. The Clean Fuel Standard, the Climate Commitment Act, the phase down of hydrofluorocarbons, and the Healthy Environment for All Act. These laws will start to turn the tide on Washington's contribution to climate change. They will improve air quality in communities experiencing the greatest environmental health disparities. And they set the pace for states across the United States, showing what can and must be done in order for us to rise to these challenges. And none of these laws would have been possible without the tenacious work of Washington conservation voters, working both the inside and outside game, talking to legislators, identifying and solving problems, and most of all, building a broad and diverse coalition spanning tribal nations, communities of color, clean energy businesses, labor unions, local elected leaders, and environmental advocates to demand climate action now. None of this work is done yet, though. We need a lot more legislative sessions like the ones we had in 2019, 2020, and 2021 if we are going to turn the tide on climate change, on protecting Washington's waters, lands, and wildlife, and on remedying environmental health disparities. And to do this, we need to continue to elect environmental champions. We need more legislators who stand in strong support of the Evergreen Future platform and know that we have no time to waste on salmon and orca recovery, on growth management, on addressing toxic threats to our health, and on the clean energy transition. Our support of Washington conservation voters is absolutely crucial if we are going to elect and re-elect leaders like Representative Dave Paul, Representative Alicia Rule, and Senator Emily Randall. I'd like to show off the beautiful award itself from my friends at WCV. I'm excited to hang this in my office in Olympia, but I'm even more excited to keep pushing forward alongside all of you in the years to come. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Representative Fitzgibbon. You are a champion for people on the planet, and we recognize your incredible work to collaborate and to listen. And these are the type of skills needed to help pass legislation that will benefit communities today and for generations in the future. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you, Joe. We're deeply grateful for your leadership. I've been with WCV for so long that I was involved in Joe's first endorsement interview back in 2012. So I look forward to the day when he can buy beer without being asked if his dad is waiting outside. When you hear about Joe's work that has been so deeply impactful on so many levels, that's what WCV does. Many of you are already thinking about important legislative and statewide races coming up in 2022 or 2024. And then you realize that local elected officials like Kim and Mona, who you just saw in this video, are not just working to implement important environmental policy every day, but they're growing into the elected champions of tomorrow. That's what WCV does. And when you consider the consequences of local elections and then see WCV working hard to elect Rebecca Lewis in Whatcom County, Brandy Donaghy in Snohomish County, Kim Convon in King County, Diana Perez and Kim Harless in the city of Vancouver, Danny Herrera in the city of Yakima, and Ginger Wireman in the city of Richland, candidates that are deeply immersed in the communities that have been hit the hardest, not just by COVID, but by decades of environmental justice. That's what WCV does. And that's what your generosity today will help us support, enhance, and empower. So thank you for supporting WCV's work at whatever level you can today. Donations are starting to roll in. Any donation of any size is welcome and deeply appreciated. And please don't forget about our matching opportunity. Thanks to that group of generous donors, we're able to match $1,000 donations dollar for dollar and all first-time donations. So jump in here now and take advantage of this very powerful chance to double your impact. It's great to see so many gifts already coming in. Thank you so much. You. Alyssa, over to you.
Thank you so much, Ken. Now for our discussion. I know folks are super excited to be here to have a discussion with two important regional leaders, Vice Chairman Shannon Wheeler of the Nez Perce Tribe and Governor Jay Inslee. Vice Chair Wheeler, thank you so much for your leadership on this issue. The Salmon Orca Summit was truly a powerful gathering that showed that Northwest tribes are united around restoring salmon. Governor Inslee, thank you for your national leadership on climate change. Thank you also for the Orca Task Force and the work on salmon recovery coming out of that process. And thank you for your work with Senator Murray on your soon to be announced Salmon Action Plan. So you both know who you're speaking to today. Folks are joining us from across the state, Washington elected officials and candidates, as well as Native leaders representing tribes from across the state and region. Both of you are focusing on an important issue to Indigenous peoples, as well as to all of us that call this place home. Salmon are part of who we all are, of what defines us. And we are at a crossroads. Salmon could go extinct if we don't take action in 2022. We all know that warming waters, coupled with declining salmon runs, ongoing litigation, and negative economic impacts on small communities that depend on salmon recreation and tourism make it clear that we need to act today. On a positive side, the recent Millman survey proves voters want to restore salmon and are positive about a comprehensive solution. Tribes through the Affiliated Tribes of Northwest Indians and the National Congress of American Indians are united in support. And the Biden administration is engaged. We have momentum. So we only have about 15 minutes, so let's go ahead and get started. Governor Inslee, to secure a solution that can be acted on by Congress next year, the clock is ticking. Time is running out for salmon. It's past time for tribes. And we have a limited window to act in DC. What is the next phase of your work with Senator Murray? And how do all of us here today help you and the senator?
Well, first off, thanks to everybody on this call. Everybody on this call has helped enormously. Elect such great leaders like Joe Fitzgibbon. By the way, Joe Fitzgibbon is the Babe Ruth of environmental policy. And if we can just clone him, he has inspired so many other legislators. Listen, I've been around for 25 years. You should retire that trophy and just call it the Joe Fitzgibbons trophy in my book. You can't overstate the impact Joe has had in the state legislature. And he's not alone. Reuven Carlisle's done some good work in the Senate. But I just want to thank Joe for his leadership. And he's right, we got more work to do. Before I answer your specific question, I want to make a comment about what we're talking about with salmon and the Snake River and the dams. And that is, when we talk about the Snake River, I think one of the first things we got to be aware of, we need to help for the salmon throughout their whole life cycle, which spans everywhere from the headwaters of the Snake through the mid-channel all the way to the Pacific. The reason I say that is we have so much work to do in so many different habitats for the salmon. I want to say that we should not forget everything we do for the salmon on the Snake. We also have to do in the mid-channel so the water's not too hot so they can't swim up the river. And in the North Pacific so that ocean acidification doesn't destroy the food chain upon which they depend. And ocean acidification is the evil twin of climate of global warming. I just want to say that so we don't forget all the work we have to do. This is one piece of it, but we got so many things we need to do for salmon. So in answer to your question, here's what I think. I think the next step is for us to define how to replace the services of the Snake River dams if they are breached. We know that they are a salmon impediment. We know that the salmon are on the verge of extinction. And we also know that they do provide services upon which a lot of folks in our economy depends. So I believe the way to advance this discussion nationally and in our state is to have a rigorous, robust, and fast assessment of how to replace those services if we breach those dams. We ought to come up with a way of how to replace that relatively carbon-free electricity. How do we replace some of the irrigation water distribution systems? How do we replace the transportation services that they provide? And I think by having those answers can do a lot to further this discussion. So I'm really happy to report that Senator Murray and I are working on a process to do that. She will make some announcements in the next couple of weeks about how to define that process. Because I think if we can develop confidence in the ability to replace those services, it's going to move this discussion a long way. Now, I'm not announcing a breaching decision today, but I am saying I'm pleased that we can and have the ability to move forward with a very vigorous answer to that question of how do we replace the services they have by next summer. Now, that's an aggressive timeline, but as you indicated, we don't have a lot of time with these salmon. So we're going to put pedal to the metal to have the best answer to that question as humanly possible next summer. And I want to thank Patty Murray for her leadership on this. And we all are hoping that she is totally successful in the reconciliation package right now that has a very strong component that can help for infrastructure devoted on our rivers and our culverts, as well as a climate change portion of the reconciliation package to answer that as well. I know she's gonna do great work with the rest of our delegation.
Thank you, Governor. Vice Chair Wheeler, the Nez Perce tribe recently released a study showing salmon extinction in the next 10 years. Declining salmon runs impact more than just your nation. What changes have you seen in the past couple of years? And how are you and tribal leaders from around Washington State and the region going to make sure that the Biden administration prioritizes salmon restoration in the Pacific Northwest?
Thank you for that question. Definitely a pleasure to be here and to share the stage or the screen with Governor Inslee and all of his work that he's done up to this point, and recognizing that there are many issues in the environment that need to be addressed, and salmon being one of those, and climate being the other, of course. You know, what we're seeing to the first part of that question, with the changes that we've seen over the past few years, is definitely subtle shifts in migration patterns and returns of wild spring Chinook into the Snake River Basin that once were in the millions and last year returned 6,200 wild spring Chinook. And with respects to the spring hatchery work that's being done, it's important to remember that those hatcheries were built to mitigate the effects of the Lower Snake River dams, and they have never met their goals. And this year, there was only like 3,000 harvestable spring Chinook to the Nez Perce tribe, which is less than one fish per tribal member. And this meant closures of our fisheries. And when we're closing our fisheries, that's taking away a part of who we are. And that commands for us to speak the truth, because something that is not being realized, that was guaranteed to us under the Treaty of 1855, is not there. And that's where congressional leaders, the administration, states need to recognize that that trust responsibility is there. And I believe that's the truth. They do recognize that. And along with that, you know, we have a lot of, as you mentioned in your opening remarks, that there's temperatures, we're experiencing unprecedented highs there. And our abilities to cool those waters, the Lower Snake River, are coming out of a reservoir that's right here on our reservation out of Dworshak. And those waters are tapped out. So what we're facing right now is that the status quo is unsustainable. And that's the science to this, is that it's unsustainable right now. And to the second part of your question is how we're notifying our getting our information to the Biden administration. First, we understand that there are tribal and environmental injustices that have happened here since the inception of and development of the Columbia River dams. The tribes in the Pacific Northwest are experiencing crisis, and they manifest themselves in different ways for each of the tribes and each of the waters that all of our tribes gather and fish. And so with that, you know, you mentioned the ATNI resolution, the NCAI resolution that has united the tribes in this common thread of what we have of salmon. You know, we have different languages with one another. We have different religions and cultures, but salmon is a common thread to each of us. And as we share that, and we're able to get that message to the administration, and for the administration to hear that and to recognize that. And the Salmon Orca Summit was great. Governor Inslee was there. He presented there. Congressman Simpson, Representative Lekanoff, State Representative, Governor Brown, Congressman Blumenauer. I mean, and the Northwest leaders, tribal leaders that were there. So that's really important to be able to get that message across to the Biden administration. We're actively engaged in the Biden administration with their departments and aligning, you know, we're finding out that our priorities are aligning with theirs. And that's key. That's key that that's happening with the administration. And, you know, we also invite all of the listeners and all the people watching right now to help the amplification of this message, and that the crisis and the environment and the salmon that we face as a nation is here and now, and we need to address that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Vice Chairman Wheeler. I really appreciate your words. I have another question for you. The science is clear The removal of the earthen berms at the of the four Snake River dams is probably our last opportunity to restore our salmon runs. For over 2 years, community leaders, elected officials, and others have been advocating for a comprehensive solution that ensures all impacted by dam removal are part of the solution. What does that look like to you?
Well, thank you for the question. That's an excellent question. And we know that what it looks like to us is that we meet the needs of the environment and fish first. That's the first thing that we need to do. We also then have to look at all the sectors. And basically, that's what Congressman Simpson has already done. We feel that the framework that he has set is the plan, that is exactly what we need to build upon to develop for the future of the Pacific Northwest and bring us into a smarter, better, stronger future. The Nez Perce tribe, you know, we definitely have interest in energy. We have interest in transportation. We have 150,000 acres in agriculture. We have tourism, recreation. So we're not just salmon people. We, you know, and many tribes across the Pacific Northwest do the same things that we do. And so we're just not only salmon, but that is a mainstay and integral part of who we are in these pieces to ensure that survival of the salmon is very important to understanding all sectors and understanding that we look at it through other lenses as well. And really that's the gist of what Congressman Simpson has done. And with leaders like Governor Inslee, Governor Brown of Oregon, Congressman Blumenauer, and even, you know, at the state levels, that having these conversations are very important. And that's what Congressman Simpson had set out to do, was let's have some conversation about this issue. Because if I guarantee that if your business touches the water, then your business touches salmon. And that's where the connection has to be recognized. And once we recognize that, then we can start working on solutions. And I always say this, I love to be in the room where there's people that like to solve problems. And problem solvers, it's very important to be in the same room as them. So we definitely appreciate the work that Congressman Simpson has done and the work of Governor Inslee and his work group and task force, Salmon Orca Task Force, that, you know, this is laying the framework to the identifying the problem and getting talking about that with all entities, because all entities need to be involved in this, because, for a stronger, smarter, better future.
Thank you so much. Governor Inslee, you spoke a little bit to this in your opening remarks. Can you tell us what a comprehensive solution looks like to you that ensures that all impacted by dam removal are part of the solution?
Well, that's what Senator Murray and I intend to pursue in the next several months, to have this wide-scale conversation of everyone who has input to answer this fundamental question. How do we replace these services that these dams provide and design a system of doing that, and seek everyone who has any particular interest, knowledge, insight, plan, or criticism about that subject as wide basis as we can? That's going to be our goal. And this is an extremely important look. We have to ask ourselves, what is the main reason there is the level of resistance against breaching right now? It is fear that all these services will be disappeared and nothing will replace them. So in order to build more public confidence and a rational discussion of this, we're going to ask everyone from wheat growers to barge owners to tribal leaders to 14-year-old beautiful kids who care about salmon to help us design and answer that question. How do we replace these services? And we're going to have a contractor who will help lead that effort to hopefully produce a report that will come back to Senator Murray and myself next summer, so that we then can consider the next step. Now, I don't want to prejudge that next step, but I do know what this state and country needs. We need to answer those questions, and we intend to get to the bottom of them. And I'm going to welcome everybody on this call to help us design those systems. We should be rigorous. We should be good listeners. We should be good listeners to those whose jobs are invested in economies supported by these dams right now. and come up with a scrupulous and scientifically valid report. And we intend to do that. Now, I want to, if I can, because I don't want to leave this conversation without adding something, because there was a question was, what would it be a comprehensive response to this problem?
Yes.
I just cannot miss an opportunity to say, we have to have a more vigorous response to climate change and carbon pollution if we're going to save these salmons as well as on the Snake River system. And I want to say that because I want to alert you that we have not done, even with the great work Joe has done, and I've done everything I can, we do not have today a system in our state that will adequately reduce the carbon pollution that are killing these salmon. We have to have more vigorous ways to reduce the growth of gas infrastructure, to make sure that our climate bill funds can actually be spent. There's a poison pill on that right now. We have to assure that we work on electrifying our transportation system, that more work needs to be done. We need vigorous response by the state legislature next session. That is necessary for the salmon survival as well. In fact, even the Joe mentioned the clean fuel standard, the legislature is threatening to try to repeal that right now, which by a lawsuit, and I find that totally unacceptable to go backwards on climate change right now. We need to go forward against climate change. So I do want to alert everyone, we've got a lot of work to do in the next session of the legislature to make sure that our salmon plan is comprehensive, that we address the snake, but also the whole life cycle, including climate. And I hope everyone will be active in that discussion next January.
Absolutely. I think we all know that we have so much work to do to address the impacts of climate change. We are seeing those impacts in real time right now. I think every time I open the news, I read something I'm an optimist by nature. I believe in the power of people. I believe in our ability to find the solutions to the issues, but we all have to come together. We all have to do the work, and we have to act with a sense of urgency. We say time is running out, literally running out. We are literally seeing it. And I know that's what gets me up every single day to do the work that I'm doing and to stay in the fight with all of you. I have one last question for you both, and Governor, I'd like you to go first. The question is, a year from now, what would you like to be able to tell your grandchildren that you accomplished that will benefit them and generations to come?
In regard to the snake, that we will have provided an answer to the question, how do we design a system that will replace the services of the Snake River dams that will then allow us to make a decision about their ultimate breaching, and that we reach that position next summer. And I believe that we are capable of doing that if we all work together. That's number one. Number two, I hope to be able to tell my grandkids that in the next session of the legislature, the Washington State Legislature produced meaningful climate change legislation, building on some of the things that were done. And of course, my vetoes helped these bills get off the ground, but we need to take the next steps. And if I can tell my grandkids they may cut me some slack because they're pretty demanding. My son, my grandson, I was walking with him last year and we're walking on this path and he says, Bobo, that's my name, Bobo, not Governor. He said, we are all nature. So they're pretty demanding and I intend to do everything for them. I hope everybody can help me.
Yeah, thank you. Vice Chairman Wheeler.
Thank you for the question. My response is visceral on what I'm going to say because it's speaking to my grandchildren. It's the salmon crisis, the climate crisis, that the President of the United States, congressional leaders, state leaders, tribal leaders, and the citizens of this republic have given the salmon, orca, and you hope.
Thank you. Whew. I want to thank you both for being here today, for your remarks, for showing up. I think we all recognize that there is an incredible amount of work to be done. And I know for myself as a woman, an Indigenous woman from the Columbia River, I think about salmon all the time. They come to me in my dreams. It feels like maybe they're talking to me. Maybe their spirits are reminding me of why you do the work. And it's that pull from my heart center to the work. And when I hear you speak, Vice Chairman Wheeler, I feel it in a way that I really can't describe. When I talk to other Native people about salmon, I also feel it right here. Spent a lot of time talking to people who fish in the Salish Sea and on the Columbia River, and they are also saying that they're not coming back. And I think we need to be asking ourselves, all of us, tribal and non-tribal, who would we be without salmon? Who would we be without salmon? And it's a question, it's our identity, it's who we are in the Pacific Northwest, it is. And for tribal people, it is so much more than that. So I appreciate all of the incredible work that you are doing. Vice Chairman Wheeler, thank you. Thank you from here, from my spirit, for everything. We stand with you. Governor Inslee, thank you for your work in addressing the impacts of climate change. I look forward to your leadership in this space. I look forward to the release of your action plan with Senator Murray. And I look forward to everyone here engaging in the process with a good heart and a good mind, and remembering that we are here to save our relative, Waikanish, the salmon. So thank you so much. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here today. I am so, so appreciative.
Thank you. Let's go get them.
Thank you. Look forward to getting the work done.
Whew. Wow, that was amazing. My heart right here is just feeling all of this. Big thank you again to Vice Chairman Shannon Wheeler and Governor Jay Inslee. We appreciate the time that you've taken today to share your insight and perspectives with us. Look, salmon are on the brink of extinction, which will impact tribes, treaties, communities, the Puget Sound, the economy, and our environment. We need a political solution, which is absolutely possible. Our strategy is to build people power and elect the right leaders to step up and collectively work with us all to decide our future. And we need your financial help with that today. Washington Conservation Voters is working to bring a new generation of political leaders who center community voices, environmental justice, and are committed to an evergreen future. We, future ancestors, you and me, must be bold and redefine what winning means. This local election year and in the years to come, we are focused on races that are critical for environmental progress. Whatcom, Kitsap, Perce, and Snohomish counties are priority areas that are critical to expanding our narrow pro-environmental majority in the Senate in the future years. And we are expanding our efforts in Central and Eastern Washington. This is the first time in over a decade that we are investing in movement building east of the Cascades. WCV takes the long view. We build people power by utilizing our voter engagement knowledge, tools, and technology to elect candidates. And we need your support to do this, to achieve the vision in our new strategic framework, that through equitable structures and systems created by statewide collaborative efforts, everyone in Washington lives in a healthy and just environment, community, and economy. I hope that you will support this vision with a financial donation. Our goal is to raise $150,000 from this event. And before we started our program today, we have raised $75,265. We're almost there. This means we need to raise an additional $75,000 from you today. We can do that if you all give something. Again, we are matching all first-time donations and gifts of $1,000. In closing, as I reflect on today's topic, the dams, the Snake River, our relative salmon, I'm reminded of a poem that I heard read this weekend on Saturday. It's written by Raina Priest. The American Book Award-winning poet, member of the Lummi Nation, and the first Indigenous Washington State Poet Laureate. It's called Love All the People. The trees are people. The animals are people. The plants are people. The fish are people. The whales are people. The mountains are people. The oceans are people. The prairies are people. Love all the people. The people are people, no matter what color, who they love, how they live, or what they believe. The people are people. Love all the people. We, future ancestors, you and I, must come together, do the hard work, and be a part of shaping our response to the climate crisis before us. We have everything we need to do that. We have all the knowledge within us. It is time for us to come together and to act with urgency. This is the time for us to do that as we write our future history that our grandchildren and their grandchildren and their grandchildren will celebrate. Thank you for being here today. And thank you so much for your financial support. We are so appreciative for everything that you do to make and keep this state as beautiful as it is.
Thank you, Alyssa, for everything you do to lead our organization and to fight for our environmental future. And thank all of you for attending today. We're doing great. We're over $50,000. We're in our last push to reach our goal of $75,000. So now is the time to donate, not just to meet those matching donations of $1,000 or any first-time donation, but to give whatever you can and what is personally meaningful to you to help us fight for the salmon, to fight for the orcas, to fight ocean acidification, to fight for a clean and more equitable transportation system, to fight for a more just economy, to fight for racial justice, and to fight for all the things that matter in our democracy. WCB is here to fight for you. So your donations today go directly to our efforts to help that fight push forward. We're actually ahead of schedule today, and I was gonna tell one more joke, but I just received word.
Oh.
Our board has voted unanimously to bar that opportunity for me. And so by legislative fiat, I say goodbye to you all today for me, and I'm gonna pass it back to Alyssa as we wrap things up. Alyssa, great job today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ken. We don't allow Ken to tell dad jokes. He really likes to, but we all veto that. Thank you again for being here. We are getting ready to close out our program. Thank you so much for showing up, for your financial support, for standing with the tribes on this issue, for following their leadership, for listening, and for taking action. We really, really appreciate that. Want to mention that there's a lot of work to do. We are working with a large coalition of organizations. Thank you for the work that you do. I'm so appreciative of the time and energy that when we come together to work in this space, it is hard work and we can't do it without one another. I'd like you to give a big round of applause to Casey Neal, a Northwest singer and songwriter who's passionate about protecting our environment and environmental justice. He's here today to sing a song about Red River, a small tributary of the South Fork in Clearwater, Ohio, which is a tributary to the Snake River. And again, thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate everything you do. Continue to be bold and welcome, Casey.
Hey, everybody. It's great to be here. Thank you, Alyssa. This song was written by a guy named Robert Hoyt. And like you said, it was about this the Red River in Idaho. And but it's connected to the snake. And so I added one last verse just to kind of draw the connection. So anyway, I'll sing it for you now and send us off.
Since time immemorial, they'd come from the sea,
Thousands of miles and they'd end their journey in the same place they began as small fry. They'd spill their loads and they'd die. A feast for the creatures and the humans too. Even then, plenty got through. They found their birthplace, no one knows how. All we know is that they don't come now. How did the Red River come by its name? Did it run red with salmon when the salmon runs came? Now all that it has come to an end, will the Red River run red again? Then the white humans came like some fatal disease, built dams, built roads, and cut down the trees. The eggs, they were crushed by the washed away land, smothered by the mud and the sand. How did the Red River come by its name? Did it run red with salmon when the salmon runs game? But now all that has come to an end, will the Red River run red again? By an Idaho river I sing of the same. There's a forest ranger station that bears its name. If you should happen to pass by that way, stop, ask them to see what they say. How did the Red River run by its name? Did it run red with salmon when the salmon runs came? But now all that has come to an end, will the Red River run red again? It's long since time to take down the dams, honor the treaties, the orca, the land. Let the Snake River again flow free as it rolls to the great Salish Sea. How did the Red River come by its name? Did it run red with salmon when the salmon runs came? But now all that has come to an end, Red River run red again. Will the Red River ever run red again?
Thank you again. Thank you, Casey. What a beautiful song. Really appreciate it. Again, thank you so much, everyone, for showing up today. My heart feels so full right now. I got to give a special shout out to all the Springers who showed up. For those who don't know what that means, that's all the tribal members from back home, the Warm Springs Indian Reservation, my people. Just appreciate you being here. Thank you to all the tribal leaders who showed up. Appreciate everything you do for the state of Washington. Friends, family, colleagues, thank you for being here today. Just feel so happy. My heart is so full. We have stayed within an hour. I know that seems really amazing for a whole entire team and all of you. Again, we will honor that by giving you back a whole 2 minutes to your lunchtime. Again, thank you for being here and have a beautiful rest of the day. Thank you.